Hey everyone, today we're going to be starting a series on Kubernetes for beginners. This series will go over how to deploy your apps on Kubernetes, how to deploy a cluster, how to configure clusters, and a lot more. This first video will kind of be an introduction. We'll touch on some of the history of Kubernetes and major Kubernetes concepts. But first, let's talk about the prereqs. One, you should have basic familiarity with the terminal. Two, you should have some kind of knowledge of a general purpose programming language. And three, you should have some familiarity with Docker. Although we will touch on that and go over some of the basic concepts of Docker and how it works. And four, you should have some knowledge of basic computing principles like how applications work, how networks happen, all that good stuff. Some of that will be a little out of scope for this video, but I'll try to do my best to explain things as they come up. So make sure to subscribe, like, and comment. It really helps the channel out. If you have any questions, make sure to join the Discord. Link's in the description. I'll be hanging out in there, answering any questions you might have. So here we go, let's get started. So Kubernetes is an open source platform for deploying and managing your containerized services, apps, and workloads. So what is a workload or an app? We can think of a workload or an app as any kind of computing that needs to happen. Now that could be a web server or some kind of data that needs to be processed or an app instance. Anything that would require computing time could be considered a workload or an app. Now let's talk a little bit about the history of Kubernetes. So Kubernetes was open sourced by Google in 2014. And originally was an internal service called Borg. Now Borg was used by engineers to scale and manage all kinds of different Google services, like the Google Home search page. And imagine thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people all at once using the Google Home search page. It just works and it works great and it's super fast, and I don't know if I've ever experienced the Google Home search page being down. Now that's the kind of highly available and super sustainable and really resilient kind of service that we're talking about here. That's the kind of thing that Kubernetes brings to you. Now, Kubernetes itself is Greek for helmsman or pilot in other cases. Now, years ago, operators would deploy their applications and their workloads onto bare metal servers, running nothing but the operating system underneath. So here we have a bunch of server stacks. And in one of these servers, we have the operating system with the kernel, binaries, all this stuff. And then underneath that, we get our app. Now, this was tedious and costly to maintain, as operators had to patch security fixes, updates, manually deploy and organize the network service mesh themselves. If you ever seen pictures online of servers with wires going between them, that was stuff that people manually would have to do by hand with literal wires. Now, more so, operators found that using these bare metal servers actually was not a sufficient use of the computing investment and the computing power. You have the operating system and your application, and that in total might take up, let's say, 75% of your power, your computing power. Now, what about the rest of this 25%? That's just not getting used. That's in the operating system. The CPU, the RAM might not be getting used to full utilization, but we're missing that 25%. That's 25% of something that we could be using. So moreover, workloads were just not utilizing all the power that these servers were giving them. And there was really no way to declaratively define how these workloads should start using up more of the actual server resources. Eventually, what began as a popular way to manage applications on bare metal servers, virtualization software allowed operators to run multiple virtual machines on a single server. So we have our one server right here, and it might have many VMs. And we'll just give this one 3 virtual machines. And this was a way to utilize 100% of the actual bare metal server's power and resources. These virtual machines are full computers on their own and have full virtualization all the way down to the CPU level. So one of these virtual machines has an entire operating system, a kernel, its own binaries, all that stuff. And then on top of that runs your app or your workload. So this fixed the problem of bare metal servers not being used to their fullest computing power and helped alleviate some of the pain around updating and deploying security fixes, operating system fixes. Instead, you could just redeploy a VM. So let's say that this one dies. You just redeploy it. And it's not tied to the hardware, but rather it's just a software layer that lives on top of the bare metal server layer. In more recent years, workloads have been deployed in containers, which are even more lightweight than VMs and take up even fewer resources. You can imagine a container sort of like an operating system, sort of like a VM, but you can have multiple containers running on a machine, and those containers utilize resources from the host operating system. So we have a VM here, it has its operating system, its kernel, its binaries, all that stuff. And we might have multiple containers running on that virtual machine. And each of those containers utilize resources from the host operating system so that we don't have to deploy our own operating system within the container or its own binaries. It can just use the things that are already there. This ends up being much more lightweight deployments, much more lightweight images that these containers have. And it doesn't necessarily need to fully virtualize. It just borrows and uses shared operating system resources from the host machine. In many ways, containers are also more portable than VMs, as they are entirely decoupled from the hardware level. So we have a container here, and it simply uses resources from the host. And the process that's doing this is some kind of container runtime like Docker. And this container being completely decoupled from the hardware enables it to be much more lightweight, much faster than deploying an entire operating system with the VM. So this is the origin of something called microservices. Small single function workloads that are designed to work together and make a mesh of services, and each one being its own little microservice. You can almost imagine these two containers here working together and talking, each performing its own function, but because they're lightweight enough, we can deploy a lot of them to make a whole mesh of services. So a big problem that comes with containers is trying to orchestrate them together. Since these are completely software level workloads running, there has to be a software solution to get them to all talk and work together. Let's say that this one needs to network with that one, and that one needs to network with all of these ones. This one only needs to run at 2 a.m. These are all problems that come with running and orchestrating containers together. Now, that's where Kubernetes comes in. With the rising popularity of these containers and microservices, Kubernetes has firmly taken the lead as the de facto way for engineers and operators to manage these containerized workloads and orchestrate them together. It's great that we have these containers, and it means a lot more lightweight deployments for our workloads, but getting them to work together, getting them to talk, it can be extremely challenging. And the underlying platform has to be extremely stable to make that happen. Now this is again where Kates comes in and makes this happen for us. So now the question becomes, why Kubernetes? Well, what kind of features does it have? There's other competitors to Kubernetes out there. One was something called Docker Swarm that would orchestrate Docker containers together. Now, Kubernetes gives operators a number of sophisticated features and technologies to utilize. It has automated rollouts and rollbacks, self-healing, seeker configuration, disk and storage orchestration, and automatic load balancing. A lot of declarative features, which is something that's been missing from orchestration for a long time. All this stuff we'll get into, but know that Kubernetes is one of the most sophisticated platforms for orchestrating your containers together. Thanks for watching, guys. I hope you enjoyed the video. Make sure to like, comment, and subscribe, and join the Discord. I'll be hanging on there answering your questions. I will see you next time.